The next item of business is a debate on motion 23408 in the name of Ruth Maguire on valuing the third sector. Can I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now, and can invite Ruth Maguire on behalf of the committee to open the debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to debate the Equalities and Human Rights Committee's Valuing the Third Sector report and our most recent budget scrutiny work, which provides an update on our views on the impact of the pandemic on the voluntary sector. Although the committee's report was published in November last year, due to the impact of the pandemic, it's not been possible to debate the report until today. I'd like to thank committee colleagues for their hard work, some of whom have now moved on, and all the people who provided written and oral evidence. In particular, I'd like to say a special thank you to Glasgow Council for the voluntary sector and the Forth Valley Third Sector interfaces in Falkirk, Stirling and Clackmannanshire. With their help, the committee held events with 60 voluntary organisations who shared their invaluable experience with us. As the Chamber knows, COVID-19 has had a disproportionate impact on many who already face disadvantage and discrimination. Our 2019 report emphasised that the voluntary sector has a valuable role to play in supporting the equality and human rights agendas in Scotland. It's therefore no surprise to us that the work of charities was key to providing immediate support to many people in their localities during the pandemic. Yet many charities are now in a situation where they may not survive for much longer. Research by the Scottish Charity Regulator found that 20% of Scottish charities are facing a critical threat to their financial viability in the next 12 months as incomes fall and demand for service grows. Today's debate is important to ensure the committee's recommendations are not lost sight of and indeed are implemented, to ensure the well-being and sustainability of the voluntary sector so it can continue to play its vital role, not just during the pandemic, but in Scotland's recovery and beyond. I'm sure members will join with me today to say a huge thank you to every single volunteer and charity worker that gives up their time to help those in their communities who are struggling to cope. During the pandemic, these individuals and organisations have leapt into action to support their communities, from providing the basic right to food to ensuring people stay connected with each other to stave off the harmful effects of social isolation. Like inequalities more generally, the pandemic has shone a light on and exacerbated the issues which already existed for the voluntary sector. The committee's recent budget work continues to highlight two core themes critical to the future of Scotland's voluntary sector. That is funding and partnership, which I'll now focus on. The committee identified last year that voluntary sector funding is complex and precarious. Many voluntary organisations operate on a complex patchwork of statutory funding, fundraised income, earned income and grant income. According to the Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisations, there are over 40,000 third sector organisations in Scotland. 40% of those organisations work in either social services or health. Around 25% of third sector income comes from public sector contracts to carry out services, much with local authorities. It's significant to the debate that local authorities receive around 40% of their total revenue income from the Scottish Government each year. Whilst the committee acknowledges that councils are under pressure to make savings, it's voluntary groups and charities feeling the force of these financial constraints. They're struggling to provide adequate service on the basis of council contracts. We heard from Ian Bruce, Glasgow Council for Voluntary Services, that as a sector, organisations were told to diversify their income away from grant funding and move towards trading, fundraising and contracts. He said, "That has been regarded as good practice. Ironically, during the COVID period, that income, which was regarded as more sustainable, has vanished, and organisations that are primarily grant-funded have been more stable." On sustainability of funding, although third sector witnesses welcomed the Scottish Government's £25 million third sector recovery programme, and existing funders had been extremely supportive and accommodating in respect of reporting on the use of the funds in the past few months, Neil Cowan, Poverty Alliance, commented that there are growing fears and anxiety about the long-term financial impact. In 2019, the committee noted the Scottish Government had moved to a three-year equalities funding cycle. We recommended other funders should follow suit and asked the Scottish Government to set up a working group involving key stakeholders to examine longer-term funding models and for its conclusions to be made available before the end of this parliamentary session. The Scottish Government, in its response to us, said, and I quote, "Duration of funding periods is a matter for other statutory funders." The committee would call on the Scottish Government to rethink its approach and to show leadership in this area, to work with other statutory funders to share the benefits of longer-term funding, to harness the Senior Leadership Forum for Change, and to bring consistency of approach and best practice through the establishment of a working group. The committee would also argue these steps are essential if the Scottish Government is to achieve its national outcomes. We are aware there's no single direct and effortless solution to the funding issues facing the sector, but the situation could be greatly improved if the Scottish Government, statutory funders like local government, independent funders and the sector itself were to work strategically together to ensure financial sustainability of the sector. Let me now move on to talk more about partnership and collaborative working. Working in partnership was a key theme that arose in our 2019 report. There was an acknowledgement from the sector that it should be looking towards collaboration, for example, co-location to cut overhead costs, working together to make addressing shared issues easier and enabling information to be shared and trust to be built. But by far the greatest barrier to partnership working was the competitive funding environment. Participants at the Forth Valley TSI event questioned how partnership could take place between third sector organisations when they were competing for the same pot of money. Fighting over funding had led to distrust in the sector. One organisation commented, "It's like a war." Conversely, the committee notes in responding to the pandemic, there have been many recent examples of strong partnership working between the voluntary sector and local authorities, the Scottish Government and the private sector that highlight just what can be achieved. At a national level, we've seen extraordinary outcomes which have been achieved through partnership working, such as the temporary eradication of rough sleeping. Success that has come from a partnership approach, shared goals between partners, and the temporary removal of hierarchy and bureaucracy. Our report called for strengthening collaboration around involvement of the sector in service design, involvement of the sector in decommissioning, and a thorough examination of partnership working in the context of a competitive funding environment. As we navigate our way through and out of this health crisis, we must look to Scotland's economic future. The scale of the inequalities and societal problems which Scotland will face in the years to come dictate that no one organisation or sector will have all the answers. As the committee noted in its report, the voluntary sector has a key role to play. The Scottish Government's response to Advisory Group on Economic Recovery commits to strengthening collaboration between the voluntary sector, local authorities and Scottish Government. It's unclear how exactly this work will be taken forward. We asked the Scottish Government how the issues raised in our report and most recent budget letter will be addressed in its economic recovery planning. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the third sector should be valued, not just for the services it provides, but also because of who it employs. For example, many women and carers who would find it difficult to find employment round their commitments. It also contributes significantly to employment skills for our young people and people with disabilities. So let us not forget that by supporting our voluntary sector, we're helping countless people to enrich their lives and the lives of others. We must embrace the adversity of the pandemic and seize it as an opportunity to do things differently. We must learn from innovative practice shown by some funders and the third sector during the pandemic. The COVID crisis has shone a light on the issues impacting the sector and on inequality in our society. Indeed, I would argue that the recommendations in the committee's report are now even more relevant. I move the motion in my name.
Thank you very much. I now call on Rachel Hamilton to speak to and move Amendment 23408.1.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move the amendment in my name. I'm delighted to be opening on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives in the debate aptly named Valuing the Third Sector. The word value allows us to debate the true extent of the worth that we place on the sector. I want to thank the Third Sector for what they do, from the Samaritans providing mental health support, the Borders Women's Aid for providing refuge for women fleeing violence, to the Scottish Council for voluntary organisations for their work in grassroots community groups. I also want to thank the Equalities and Human Rights Committee for their work in conducting this important inquiry into funding of the Third Sector in Scotland. We've heard from the length and breadth of the sector during the inquiry, and I'm glad that the committee has come to a conclusion on the best way forward for assisting the sector during these difficult times. Charities and other organisations have worked tirelessly throughout the pandemic to provide support and comfort to lonely, disabled, sick and vulnerable people in our society. They've been pushed to the limits during stressful times, and we on these benches believe they deserve better. The Third Sector is crucially important to Scotland, employing over 100,000 people in Scotland and providing invaluable help to all areas of society. The funding conundrum is not a new one, as highlighted by Ruth Maguire. For too long, this government have left the Third Sector in an insecure position, with cuts to local authority spending having a negative effect on their long-term viability. This is not a consequence of the pandemic. Over the course of the decade, this government has cut the budget to promoting equalities and human rights by 10%. According to the Scottish Government, they claim its equalities and human rights budget supports the drive for social justice, economic and inclusive growth, and community resilience and empowerment. But we know that it is just 0.07% of the total Scottish Government discretionary budget. It's true, Presiding Officer, I want to keep my contribution positive and the work with the Government to ensure recommendations are actioned, but it is hardly a ringing endorsement for this Government. We have heard in the report how fragile the financial situation is, with short-term funding cycles causing instability in some Third Sector organisations, creating issues around staff retention and development. SCVO made this point in their briefing for today's debate by highlighting that the Scottish Government's promising of longer term funding are often, and I quote, very rarely seen in practice. I note from the recommendations that the committee asked the Scottish Government to set up a working group, which Ruth Maguire talked about, involving key stakeholders to examine the longer term funding models available to statutory funders and for its conclusions to be made available before the end of the parliamentary session. That timeline would surely tie in nicely as part of the interim report called for by the Scottish Conservative Party today. Rurality, combined with the lack of long-term funding and reduced opportunities, is posing problems for the Third Sector organisations in recruiting staff in many rural areas. This was echoed by Dumfries and Galloway Health and Social Care Partnership. And I know across the borders too, it's very difficult for organisations to feel part of not only a local authority budget scrutiny, but also be involved at Scottish Government level. The Scottish budget approach has been criticised as being opaque to the public and key stakeholders, particularly the Third Sector, and it should go without saying the Scottish Government must do more to make use of public money more visible to stakeholders and encourage participation. Last week in the Equally Safe debate, I highlighted the need for more secure funding, especially for women's charities such as Borders Women's Aid that tackle violence against women. In their briefing, Engender mentioned a shortage of suitable refuge accommodation as being exacerbated by restriction on movement combined with a lack of temporary housing options during lockdown, leaving women with an impossible choice to stay in an unsafe home or risk homelessness. We need to see more sustainable funding that gives charities flexibility and financial backup to support their goals of helping more women flee a violent household to a safe space. We know how competitive the funding environment is for the Third Sector, especially for rural organisations of which I represent. I'm glad the committee has highlighted this, and it is hugely disadvantageous for smaller charities and organisations. This must be addressed at government level as a matter of urgency, because the work of grassroots and smaller charities are absolutely invaluable and part of our fabric of our constituencies. Presiding Officer, turning to the Scottish Conservative amendment today, we on these benches believe it's important to see an interim reporting of progress made on the recommendations detailed by the committee. If we are to see positive results for the third sector in the short and long term, there must be a midway point where we can hold the government to account and measure that improvement. We simply cannot end up years down the line where no progress has been made and there was no accountability for that delay. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I want to once again thank the committee for their work on the inquiry and producing a constructive and detailed set of recommendations. I believe if acted upon in full, will deliver real and progressive change for the third sector. There is another way that we could find a solution to this, and that would be to also take upon the Scottish Conservatives' idea to create a permanent financial settlement for councils that would stop any successive government from raiding budgets and cutting vital local funding for third sector organisations. Our amendment today commits to interim reporting on the recommendations set out by the committee's finding, and we must ensure that this government are held to account in their progress. As I finish, I want to reflect on some observations by the Samaritans, who said, COVID-19 has seen a renewed sense of community resilience and altruism from the people of Scotland. The Scottish Government should not let this moment pass and must reflect the value it believes the third sector brings to Scottish society. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, and I now call on Christina McKelvey on behalf of the Scottish Government.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. At a time when we are faced with responding to a global pandemic and the unwanted uncertainty that Brexit is bringing to our country, I would like at the outset of this debate to express my thanks, my gratitude and my admiration for the way in which the third sector has mobilised to support the people and communities who have been so badly affected by COVID-19. It is this tireless commitment to helping others and to working collaboratively with the Scottish Government and others that has played such a major part in ensuring that those who need support have been able to access that support. We should all remember that their work to support those in need began long before this pandemic, and when we emerge from this pandemic, this excellent work will continue. I am glad, therefore, that the committee has chosen to recognise the work of our third sector partners in this report, and this debate rightly marks this vital contribution. That contribution should be central to our thinking as we recover from the pandemic. I am pleased that within the Equality and Human Rights, we have overseen the single largest increase in our budget, seeing it increase from £24.6 million in 2019-2020 to its highest ever level of currently £30.2 million. This additional budget uplift is investing in a range of third sector organisations working to secure the best outcomes for Scotland's people. My budget continues to promote equality and human rights by supporting a wide range of organisations working to achieve equality across the range of protected characteristics, and will continue to support a range of Scottish Government priorities and commitments. In this time where we acknowledge the 16 days of activism, as we did in this Parliament last week, we know that much more must be done to prevent gender-based violence. We will continue to support the important work of those in the third sector to tackle all forms of violence against women and girls. For example, from the first round of the Wellbeing Fund, over £1.5 million was allocated to Scottish Women's Aids and Rape Crisis Scotland to support service redesign and ensure vital third sector specialist services could continue to support women and children during the pandemic. Over £1.7 million has been provided each year for the last 3 years to disabled people's organisations to support projects to promote equality, disability equality. Helping to provide and enable those with lived experience of disability to play a part in the development of policies to solve problems and dismantle barriers. We have provided over £1.16 million to support for older people's organisations at both national and local community level, with community projects being supported to support older people. One of the issues raised by the committee was the use of multi-year funding, and I am pleased to say that we have been able to provide multi-year funding over the last three-year period. That ensures this efficient time and support for applications, the application process and support partnership working on fair work principle ideals. The Equality and Human Rights budget will support the launch of two new funding streams which will support the third sector. Our new Delivering Equally Safe Fund will develop and deliver work which directly contributes to delivering the ambitions of our Equally Safe strategy. I will launch this fund very shortly, and we will announce successful applicants in summer 2021 to allow for projects to start in October 2021. In addition, Presiding Officer, our Support on Equalities and Human Rights Fund will support organisations to advance equality and support the realisation of human rights. I will launch this fund in early 2021, with successful applicants again being announced in summer 2021, again with projects starting in October 2021. Both these funds will run for 3 years, so that's that commitment to that multi-year funding, and they will run until September 2024, providing certainty and stability for the longer-term work. I would like to return to the Advisory Group on Economic Recovery, as mentioned by Ruth Maguire, the convener, in her opening remarks. This was established to advise on Scotland's economic recovery in the wake of COVID-19. And as the convener made specific mention in her opening remarks, in their report published in June, they recognised the depth and breadth and the reach of the third sector and asked us to put this at the heart of planning for the recovery and renewal. In response to that report, we recognise the need for effective partnership working, and that recognition of the vital role has been central to the decision to increase the equalities budget, and I would hope that would reassure the committee and its members. We are committed to progressing the recommendations in the committee's report and to addressing the barriers faced by the sector by strengthening collaboration between the Scottish Government, local government and the third sector. And can I just turn to the amendment in the name of Rachel Hamilton today? I know Rachel Hamilton is not actually on this committee, but I would like to reassure her that we do regularly update the committee on progress, and I've already done so in my letter in October. She'll maybe realise, possibly if she was on the committee, that a number of the areas cut across many other portfolios, and I have updated the committee this October on a number of streams from across every part of government, and I hope that it gives a fuller response to the committee's report. Funding and partnership working are rightly central to our thinking, and they both form a part of the bigger strategic picture and everything else that we do. In responding to a recommendation made by her Advisory Council on Women and Girls, the First Minister announced earlier this year the establishment of a new directorate for equality, inclusion and human rights within the Scottish Government, and I'm sure the committee will be following its work with interest. This new directorate will bring a strategic focus to our work to embed equality and human rights into all of the work that we do. It will ensure that our capacity is to embed equality and human rights across all areas of government is strengthened, and our work with the third sector will be central in achieving that ambition. We can all recognise that what we know as part of the parcel of functions of government today have their roots in the past, through the efforts of countless people who have effectively played their part from the charity sector and the third sector. For example, universal suffrage, free education, free healthcare, social housing are all a product of people standing up for that ideal. And we can all see the impact of the third sector now on our policy decisions and our ideas through the campaigns that they champion all through the third sector have a deep impact on the work that we do in government. And reflecting upon those achievements, I am reminded of the words of Michelle Obama. And her words were, there is no magic to achievement. It's really just about hard work, choices and persistence. And it is this hard work, hard choices and persistence that is so often a hallmark of the untiring work of our third sector in Scotland. As we look to the future, we cannot underestimate the challenges we face. None of us do. This government's focus on achieving an equal and fair Scotland is unwavering. And it is this focus on equality and fairness that will underpin our efforts to meet those challenges. So in closing, Presiding Officer, I'd like to thank the committee for their hard work and perseverance in producing this report and for their careful consideration of the evidence presented by all who contributed. I would also again like to acknowledge the work of the countless people in the third sector who are key to realising our ambitions of a fairer Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Pauline McNeill.
The third sector in Scotland has carried out an invaluable role in dealing with COVID-19 and under incredibly difficult circumstances, and we all agree that we owe the third sector a debt of gratitude. But I'd also like to mention the many community groups who sprung up during the pandemic, delivering food and comfort to those who desperately needed it. The relationship between the third sector and the public sector needs a fundamental shift, so we must begin a new partnership-based style of working. The voluntary sector delivers vital services to our communities, and we can't do without it. It's in fact far larger than you might think, with over 40,000 organisations employing over 100,000 paid staff. But it is a sector struggling to cope with decreasing budgets and funding. The FCVO reports that 20% of charities reported a critical threat to the financial viability, over the next 12 months, and it says that the sector faces immediate risk. SCVO also notes that the Scottish Government has reiterated its commitment to longer-term funding for the sector, which it describes as words we have heard before, but rarely seen in practice. And similarly, NSPCC Scotland notes that the local authority budgets have shrunk over a number of years, and that this has had a knock-on effect for the support that the third sector is able to provide. Since the start of the pandemic, charities have had a chance had to cancel fundraising events, which has led to a loss of income providing services. But the demand for charities has absolutely been surging. Jones and Colitis UK, a charity that I work with, is such a lifeline to many people, and many young people in particular. SCVO is also at the forefront of UK-wide Never More Needed campaign, which emphasises that in the face of the coronavirus, charities have never been more needed for the essential support they provide. Over a third of charities are reporting an increase in demand, while frontline services report an exponential increase in demand. For example, in October, Citizens Advice Bureau issued the highest number pieces of advice in 1 month since the beginning of lockdown. And the figures also revealed a continued increase in demand for service on debt. And a survey showed by NCVO in March found that over half of the charities, that's 52%, plan to reduce services. So that's extremely concerning. But it's evidence to the Equalities Committee that Fraser of Allender Institute noted that parents and people with disabilities have been particularly impacted by the effects of the pandemic. We already knew that these families are the poorest. But they highlight the scandal of care packages being taken away because of reprioritisation. This has led to a real worsening in standard of living. For some cases, family carers have had to try to pick up the slack. Engender notes that a reduction in social care packages has led to an increase in the number of unpaid carers in Scotland to 1.1 million, and it's 61% who are women. In general, the situation for most parents has improved with schools going back, but schools are still having to send children home, and children are often having to self-isolate with no childcare infrastructure available, which means a loss of parents, and mothers in particular are struggling. Women have to make trade-offs to keep their families functioning, which means that sometimes their working lives have had to take a back seat. So we do need to make sure, in analysing what's happened during the pandemic, that we're not taking a backward step in the achievements we've made for women. As we know, and mentioned by other speakers, there has been a steep rise in domestic abuse during the pandemic. We've debated it many times before. Scottish Women's Aid is calling for a new fund model to ensure adequate and effective support. Funding for domestic abuse services remains precarious, with groups increasingly relying on grants from organisations such as the Big Lottery to supplement inadequate government funding. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the government does need to learn lessons from its current funding model and respond to the times that we are in. It's human rights and equalities are always taken into account when dispersing funds in the future. We cannot do without the third sector. They've been so vital to us up until now, and they will be in the years ahead. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Beatrice Wishart.
Presiding Officer, we've seen how COVID-19 has exacerbated existing inequalities. This debate on funding for the third sector and on securing equalities and human rights is urgent, and I'm pleased to be able to contribute today. Like other members, I'd like to begin by paying tribute to the way the third sector across Scotland has responded to the pandemic. And I'd also like to highlight the invaluable work of the third sector in my own constituency of Shetland. People came together for the common good to tackle this dreadful virus and look out for friends and neighbours, showing that our communities pull together when faced with challenges and demonstrating how invaluable the third sector is. Voluntary Action Shetland had the fantastic idea to launch the Shetland Community Spirit Awards 2020 earlier this year to celebrate and recognise volunteering during the pandemic and those who give so much to their communities. 65 awards were handed out to individuals, organisations and businesses. If more evidence was needed of Shetland's community spirit, the latest statistics from the Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisations show that there are 232 charities in Shetland. Only the Western Isles has more per 1,000 people population. It is estimated that 55% of adults in Shetland volunteer formally, almost double the national average. And there are countless more informal ways that people in Shetland help out in their community. But of course, dedicated staff and volunteers in the third sector need much more than just warm words from politicians. In the SCVO organisation's third sector forecast for 2019, 88% of respondents from rural areas believe the sector's financial situation would worsen. The picture will almost certainly have worsened further still, as organisations have been prevented this year from fundraising in the normal way, while demand for services has increased. Liberal Democrats want to see the third sector provided with as much certainty as possible with funding from both local and national government, recognising the contribution they make, the demand they respond to, and the need for continuity of services. Indeed, the third sector is well placed to get things moving in the renewal and recovery phase. The committee's letter to the Scottish Government of 29th October 2020 details that it is disproportionately women who are unpaid carers and that carers face barriers in realising their rights even before the pandemic. Caring can have an adverse impact on the carer's health and well-being. Sometimes this can be particularly the case for young unpaid carers, as their education can suffer and ultimately their life opportunities. There was no respite for carers during lockdown, when adult daycare services were stopped for months on end with no light at the end of the tunnel. It left many feeling like they'd been forgotten. The third sector stepped in to pick up some of the pieces, like the Shetland Befriending Scheme's COVID-19 telephone befriending service for people affected by dementia. The committee makes an important recommendation that the role of unpaid carers be translated into actions in the recovery plan. As we rebuild from the pandemic, work to ensure unpaid carers and their families get the support and recognition they deserve will benefit from the third sector and the Scottish Government working together in partnership. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And we now move to the open debate, and I call Fulton McGregor to be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a member of the Equalities and Human Rights Committee, it gives me great pleasure to speak in today's debate. And I'm sure that we all agree today that the third sector plays a vital role in our society. They undertake so many different responsibilities in our communities and have the tough but crucial job of providing lifeline services to many. We are indebted to these services, and that is why it is absolutely right that the government invests in the region of £500 million annually in the third sector. And hasn't this year put into stark contrast the value of the third sector? As a committee, we started taking evidence in this before COVID-19 was even a thing, if we can remember those days. But for anyone, if such a person even exists, who didn't value the third sector, they surely would now. When the pandemic and greatest challenge of our lives struck, it was the third sector organisations that stood up to the plate first in our communities, mainly being the only link to the local community for those who were lonely and isolated during the lockdown. I myself volunteered and saw some of the excellent work done in Coatbridge and Creyson to provide food, befriending, advice and support to those who needed it at this hard time. It struck me what a huge burden they were taking off the public sector, who themselves were already stretched and doing amazing work. So from the Glenboig Development Trust to Kirkshaw's Neighbourhood Centre, from the Stay Connected Project to Coatbridge Food Bank and Lanarkshire Community Food, from the CAB, from Albion Rovers Supporters Trust, community councils, church groups, and the many more that I do not have time to mention in just 4 minutes. Thank you. Thank you for all you have done and continue to do. Because the sad reality is, Presiding Officer, these services and the many others across Scotland are still needed, and demand is very much high going into the winter months and, of course, as we experience this second wave. We must continue to fully appreciate and value this sector. And that's why I very much welcome the announcement of a further £15 million for the Communities and Third Sector Recovery Programme to support the work of local organisations. Presiding Officer, and on that point, as we move from the immediate response to recovery, the Scottish Government will now refocus part of the Communities Fund into a £25 million Community and Third Sector Recovery Programme, which will include business support and investment to help organisations adapt their operations and income generation to increase sustainability. This funding will support the third sector in continuing to provide people and communities with services in response to the ongoing impact of the pandemic. The Scottish Government will begin work to explore other strands of social investment, including capital loans, to support the sector to work together. and co-locate as the demand for office space declines, whilst leaving organisations with an asset in future years to enhance sustainability and ensuring that this benefits all areas, particularly those hardest hit by the crisis. The Scottish Government is also committed to working with partners across Scotland to ensure that volunteering is for all, that we're able to tackle inequality and dismantle the barriers to volunteering. Presiding Officer, I say this to demonstrate this Government's commitment to this sector, but is it fully enough? Possibly not. In our report, as a committee, has highlighted where we need to go further. It is also true that we could have all the money in the world and it may never be enough. And that's because you can't put a price on communities coming together and responding in loving kindness, the like that we've seen earlier this year. But what we have to do is value our third sector, fund it as much as possible, and support it to thrive through the rest of this pandemic and beyond, far into the future. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. I now call Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Annabel Ewing.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I welcome this debate on the value and importance of the third sector. And as someone who worked in that area for a number of years, I understand the importance that they play here in Lothians and across Scotland. The increase in demand for services resulting from COVID-19 has brought into sharp focus the tremendous importance the third sector plays in the lives of many in our communities. Worryingly, the pandemic also continues to shine a light on the financial difficulties many in the third sector suffer. During COVID-19, more than half of third sector organisations have lost funding income, with the cancellation of fundraising events, the closing of charity shops, etc. For example, in May, Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland lost £500,000 a month in fundraising income, whilst reporting an 80% increase in demand for its community support services. The implication for those that rely on their vital support, including disabled people living with long-term health conditions and unpaid care, is too hard to overstate. However, as highlighted by SGVO, whilst the impact of COVID-19 pandemic has understandably drawn much focus and attention, the work of the committee clearly shows that many of these points were already there before this happened. A poll conducted by SGVO back in December 2018 reported that staff faced a battle for funding, but an increase in demand for the organisational services, whilst 82% of charities said they were worried about the challenges caused by funding cuts. Third sector funding is a challenge. As an MSP, I have the privilege of engaging with charities and going around talking to many of them over the last 4.5 years. The very nature of a third sector funding means it is often gathered in a piecemeal fashion from grants, earned income, strategy funding, and fundraising. Timescales are variable, grants are unpredictable, and many organisations simply do not know if they are going to be there next year. The Equality and Human Rights Committee reported that a quarter of all funding for the third sector comes from public sector contracts, many funded by local authorities. Yet, despite continual increases to the Scottish budget, the SNP have been raiding council budgets to fund their pet projects. This has run down local services and pushed the third sector to the limit. Since the SNP came to power, local government funding as a percentage of government spending has fallen 35.9% to 33.1%. This has a damaging effect on the third sector. They find it difficult to plan for the future and they are unsure what tomorrow will bring. If anything, this crisis has shown us, as Ruth Maguire pointed out in her speech, that we do need the third sector to come together, to work in partnership and to work across different sectors. But this will always be hampered by going after the same pot of money. And Scottish Government and we as politicians need to see how we can address that going forward. The Scottish Conservatives would give councillors a fair deal to ensure that they can fund a vital third sector. The Scottish Conservatives would create a permanent financial settlement for councils, stopping us working out year by year, but looking at a three-year funding package, which is ring-fenced to make sure the third sector know what's going to. We must all appreciate the vital role of a voluntary sector plays in our community, but it's not enough just to give warm words. It needs to be backed up with money and long-term funding put in place. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Annabel Ewing, to be followed by James Kelly.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I too am pleased to be called to speak in this debate on valuing the third sector. And perhaps just before I begin my remarks, just picking up on something that the previous Tory speaker said, Mr. Balfour, he referred to SNP pet projects. I don't know if he was referring to important initiatives such as ensuring that hungry children are fed, or perhaps the Scottish child payment described as a game changer in tackling child poverty, or indeed the £100 million winter hardship fund to be available to help families who are really struggling to get a bit of help to get them through the winter. I just leave that there, Presiding Officer. But I am pleased to speak in this debate, and I very much commend the work of the Equalities and Human Rights Committee, and they have produced an excellent report, and we understand why we're debating it now, some 12 months later, but it's an excellent report. And I do commend also the work of the organisations who took the time to participate in the various processes that the committee engaged in to secure as many views as possible. And in advance of today's debate, obviously we have received many submissions from excellent third sector organisations outlining actions they have taken over recent months, and also, of course, making an ask in terms of funding. And I'm sure that those have landed also on the Cabinet Secretary's desk, and that she will be looking at those very carefully indeed as we come to the budget period. And one particular submission struck me, Presiding Officer, and that was from the Samaritans. And at this time of particular anxiety and uncertainty and upset, indeed after the many, many long months of the COVID-19 restrictions, and as we prepare for Christmas, I think it is very important to flag up that, of course, as is the case always, to those who need some emotional support, will be there for them over the Christmas period. This is a free telephone number, and of course confidentiality is guaranteed. And I repeat, I will mention the number, I think, Presiding Officer, I think that would be important, and it is 116 123. And I would urge anybody who feels that they need that help at the end of the phone or by email to contact the Samaritans, who are trained in providing that help and assistance. Presiding Officer, the third sector, of course, has indeed been pivotal in Scotland's response to the pandemic, as has been mentioned. And it has been there to help people and communities get through. And therefore, it was very pleasing indeed at the very beginning, which seems a long time ago, to see the Scottish Government announce the £22 million Resilience Fund, which it managed through, I'm sure, a lot of hard work behind the scenes to see open for business as early as the 25th of March of this year. And this fund, together with other funding streams that were subsequently made available, were pivotal also in ensuring that the third sector could do what it is excellent at doing, which is helping individuals and communities to get through the challenges facing them, and in particular, of course, the challenges generated by the pandemic. And during that time, discussion also was had about what happens next. And I'm very pleased to see that the Scottish Government announced in the Programme for Government the £25 million Community and Third Sector Recovery Programme. And indeed, this fund is intended to help third sector organisations adapt to the challenging circumstances we continue to face and the new circumstances we face as a result of COVID, and to adapt the way in which they operate and generate their income. And this fund, I'm sure, will be very important in helping third sector organisations to do just that. And of course, there is an examination of a possible capital loan scheme as well, in terms of the need that will be the case for many organisations to relocate into one setting in light of the decline in demand for office space. So there has been a lot of activity undertaken by the Scottish Government to help the third sector through to the other side of the pandemic. And I commend, and I would take this opportunity to do so, Presiding Officer, in particular, the evident commitment of the Cabinet Secretary, who has shown her determination to fight her corner for her department and to make a real difference to people's lives. In conclusion, I would wish to thank every single volunteer, charity worker and community champion who have gone the extra mile to make such a difference in my constituency of Cowdenbeath and indeed across Scotland. And in my constituency of Cowdenbeath, I think it would be important to thank once again the volunteers at the Eat Recythe project and the Wee Cafe in Kelty. And just the other weekend, fantastic volunteers from Benarty and from Lochgarry spent their whole weekend collecting food and financial donations from the most generous communities of Benarty and Lochgarry. They collected over 3,000 kilos of food and over £2,200 in just one weekend. Where on earth, Presiding Officer, would we all be without such determined volunteers and such outstanding communities? Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. I call James Kelly, to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Thanks a lot, Deputy Presiding Officer. This is a timely debate and gives the Chamber an opportunity to thank those in the third sector who have made such a tremendous contribution over the period of the pandemic. From my point of view as a Glasgow Region MSP, I want to thank the many citizens' advice bureaus throughout Glasgow that have stepped in and done such excellent work, and also organisations like LEAP and Halfway and Healthy and Happy in Rutherglen, who have been at the centre of many community efforts. I also want to thank the committee for the report that they've produced and the work that they've done, because I think it lays a good platform for the budgetary challenges that the third sector face in the 2021 budget coming up, because there's no doubt the pandemic makes demands on the budget, but also makes tremendous demands on the third sector. If you look at what's happened over the course of the pandemic, of course there have been health challenges for people. People have been left isolated and on their own. There have been employment challenges. People have lost their jobs or had to work from home or do part-time work. And that's left a lot of people vulnerable and needing help, and that's where the third sector has been required to step in. And I think there's been a particular issue, particular challenge for women. I was particularly concerned reading the Engender briefing that the number of unpaid carers in Scotland has gone up to 1.1 million, it's gone up 392,000 in recent times, and 61% of those carers are women. So I think there's the organisations that have highlighted the impact that the pandemic has had on women, I think that's got to be a focus of the budgetary demands going forward. I think we also need to look clearly at how the money is allocated. Although it's welcome that there's a resilience fund being put in place, it deeply concerns me that South Lanarkshire, I don't feel, has been fairly treated. If you look at the allocations per head in terms of the way the grants are paid out, South Lanarkshire Council at £1.5 per head in terms of the allocations is the third lowest in Scotland. And that compares with the Western Isles at £15.5 a head. Yeah, surely.
I just think
Cabinet Secretary.
More just for a point of clarity, I'm not sure which fund James Kelly is referring to specifically, but I think I would urge him to look at the information we've published across a range of the different funds to look at what other areas that South Lanarkshire has been supported in.
James Kelly.
Well, just to answer you directly, I'm quoting from the Scottish Government's own website and the analysis that is appendix one in the paper, and I'd also point you to the fact that in that resilience fund, Highland Council were paid out £1.273 million and South Lanarkshire only got £337,000. Have I got time?
There is indeed time and it's a debate, so it's up to
you. All right.
I would just urge him again to look at not just the Third Sector Resilience Fund, but the Community Wellbeing Fund and the Supporting Communities Fund, again, and look at the South Lanarkshire allocations across a whole range of different funding streams that were distributed, not just to one authority, but a range of them.
James Kelly.
I'm looking at the in terms of this debate, we're looking at the support for the third sector, and it concerns me that Highland Council is getting nearly £1 million more than South Lanarkshire. The minister, the two front bench ministerial teams well understand South Lanarkshire and the demands on the third sector. So I think it's of great concern that South Lanarkshire is £1 million less than Highland. No disrespect to Highland and securing that applications, but I think we need to be given much more support than we're seeing from the Resilient Fund. So going forward, there are significant issues in terms of... No, I think of... Is there time?
Everybody's looking at me with anticipation. I feel so powerful. yes, you can take it, Mr. Kelly.
Yeah,
this time.
Yes,
Emma Harper.
Thank you. Thank you for taking the intervention. I'm interested if we're just looking at sums of 1 million versus 500,000 for every region. How, you know, don't we need to dissect it further because there are issues of rurality that need to be considered, whether it's Lanarkshire or the Highlands?
James Kelly.
I'm sure I accept that point, but I point you to the fact that if you look at South Lanarkshire in areas of Cambus Lang, Rutherglen, Hamilton and Clydesdale and the significant challenges that COVID has presented, look at that area is in a tier 4 lockdown. So therefore, the third sector is going to face much more demands in that area than it has in other areas in Scotland. And you've got to pose the question, as I keep posing, why is the funding that they've got from the Resilient Fund significantly less? As I was going on to say, I think there are real issues for the budget going forward in terms of the third sector, because what you're seeing is you're seeing demand going up and the ability of these third sector groups to fundraise has been limited, so their funding's limited. So aside from the issues I have raised, I think in terms of examining the draft budget for next year, we need to look at how much money is available to the third sector and also how that is distributed. So in summing up, I'm glad I've provoked a wee bit of debate, Deputy Presiding Officer. but in summing up, can I thank the committee for the report, because I think they do shine a light on the significant work the third sector carries out, but also on how we fund the third sector going forward to deal with the issues that the pandemic has brought forward.
Thank you, Mr. Kelly. And I call Rona Mackay to be followed by Alison Harris. Ms. Mackay, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to be speaking in this afternoon's debate at a time when the voluntary sector has never been more important. But of course, we know it's vital all year round in normal times, and the sector is a crucial partner embedded in our society. Put frankly, all governments rely on a functioning, well-run voluntary sector. They're a core partner to the work of government. Presiding Officer, supporting businesses has been central to dealing with this pandemic, and rightly so. All businesses have been hit extremely hard, and it's right that they should be given a lifeline. Thousands of jobs are at stake, and it's an incredibly worrying time for businesses. However, I do think the voluntary sector should be considered in an equal light, as a society can't function without the great work that they do. The helpful briefing from the Scottish Council of Voluntary Organisations remind us that voluntary sector funding in Scotland is complex and precarious. I know from my own constituency, and as others have said, most operate on a jigsaw of statutory funding, fundraised income, earned income and grant income. The SCVO say there's no silver bullet to the funding issues facing the third sector. They welcome the Scottish Government's financial support, but say that even with this investment, there's continued financial uncertainty for the sector, with 20% of charities reporting a critical threat to their financial viability in the next 12 months. Presiding Officer, the Equalities and Human Rights budget allocation has been significantly increased and now stands at its highest level of 38.2 million, up from 24.6 million in 2019-20. Crucially, there's the £25 million Community and Third Sector Recovery Programme, which aims to support charities, community groups, social enterprises and voluntary organisations that are supporting people and communities through the shift from lockdown to recovery. And I'm delighted that the Scottish Government is also increasing support to the violence against women and girls sector through revised funding streams and supporting work to embed quality and human rights more firmly across government. So that's the good news, but these are not normal times, and the third sector, social enterprise in particular, has been severely impacted during the crisis. And quoting figures and statistics doesn't always mirror what is happening on the front line. There's no doubt the third sector would have a much greater chance of securing regular and realistic funding if the Scottish Government had the financial levers to do so. Not knowing our budget allowance from Westminster from 1 year, what it will be from 1 year to the next, severely hampers our ability to reassure the sector of sustained funding. That said, the Government has committed to seek to extend three-year rolling funding where possible and is actively progressing this work, striving wherever possible to confirm future grant offers before the preceding funding period ends. We know that local support will normally be the responsibility of the local authority, and the Government is encouraging all funders to consider longer-term funding wherever possible. Presiding Officer, in my constituency of Strathkelvin and Bearsden, we're extremely fortunate to have a thriving voluntary sector. In fact, my constituency officer joins the Eastern Bartonshire Voluntary Association Office, a fantastic body that coordinates the many strands of voluntary agencies throughout the area. And during this pandemic, as in other areas, the sector has come into its own. From new community groups working to deliver food and help to vulnerable residents, to established agencies working 24/7. And like others, I would like to thank them sincerely. The acts of kindness, generosity and compassion across our communities have told a story about Scotland and its people that we need to celebrate and build on. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, we've seen the enormous contribution to the voluntary sector has made during this terrible pandemic. We must build on that going forward because a thriving third sector is vital to Scotland and it's an essential partner to government. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Mackay. I call Alison Harris, we followed by Emma Harper. Ms. Harris, please. I think my microphone is on now. No. Is the card working properly? Oh goodness, there. Well, that's exciting. So no. You'll have to move because it's for the official report. So can you move to another seat? I realise that's not exactly the best system, but I'll tell you what, I'll take Emma Harper and I'll come back to you. That happened to me the other day, so we've got that in common. I'll take Emma Harper if she's ready. Thank you. Yes, Ms. Harper, you've got lift off.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am ready. Although I'm not a member of the Equalities and Human Rights Committee, I am interested to speak as I've had much involvement with the third sector organisations across Dumfries and Galloway. And I too thank all the hard work of the committee members and the clerks for producing this report and everyone in the sector for all their hard work, especially during this COVID-19 pandemic. Presiding Officer, I'm also Deputy Convener of the Health and Sport Committee, and earlier this year we conducted a short inquiry with a report, Social Prescribing, Physical Activity is an Investment, Not a Cost. Today's report, Valuing the Third Sector, has many similarities with the Social Prescribing Report, and one of the overarching conclusions in our report was that there is not enough investment in social prescribing activities which can help support people with physical and mental health well-being. And many of these social prescribing activities are delivered by third sector organisations, including Third Sector Dumfries and Galloway. Presiding Officer, the third sector plays a crucial role supporting community development, inclusive growth and providing lifeline services, facilities and employment to people across Scotland. The third sector also provides funding for life-changing social prescribing models to help people with a range of health conditions, from depression and anxiety to addiction and isolation. Indeed, one example of a fantastic partnership project is the River Garden community at Auchincruith in Ayr. I've spoken about River Garden many times in this session. It's a residential alcohol and drugs recovery service who use a social prescribing approach to recovery from alcohol and drugs misuse. The team did well to engage the community and reduce stigma and enhance the human rights of the River Garden residents. The programme works in partnership with and receives third sector funding. This is a strong example of partnership working, which is called for in the committee report and which Ruth Maguire described in her opening. And it's a strong example of how supporting the third sector can in turn help support people, our society and our economy. And it is interesting to read in the report that one of the conclusions in paragraph 137, where the committee asks the Scottish Government to direct or encourage a great focus on human rights and partnerships within the third sector, within the budget process. And I welcome this. Presiding Officer, I welcome that the government-funded Third Sector Resilience Fund, which opened for applications on the 25th of March this year, it has a welcome lifeline for many organisations across D&G and Scotland. And £22 million of funding was made available through the fund as part of £80 million allocated to the third sector and community organisations such as Third Sector D&G. They were able to offer grants to community groups across Scotland, as well as to support their own efforts during the pandemic to prevent social isolation and loneliness. I volunteered myself with the third sector D&G during the initial lockdown. I participated in the telephone touch base scheme, where I was able to speak to people who identified as being at risk of isolation or loneliness as a consequence of lockdown. There is no doubt that this fund helped many people across Scotland, and I would appeal to the Minister to ensure that the new £25 million of Community and Third Sector Recovery Fund continues to work to tackle isolation and loneliness, as well as funding lifeline services across Scotland. Presiding Officer, I again welcome the engagement and support that Third Sector have provided for Auchincruith River Garden and look forward to that continuing. And I again echo the findings of this report in emphasising the importance of value in the third sector and appeal to the Scottish Government to ensure that it is funded adequately to enable the fabulous, outstanding third sector work to continue in the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Harper. I now call Alison Harris, to be followed by George Adam. Ms Harris, please.
Thank you. Before I begin, I would like to declare an interest, being involved with a third sector charity, and I would refer members to my register of interests. Deputy Presiding Officer, the third sector in Scotland is in a dire situation. All across the country, organisations covering every imaginable cause have never faced a more worrying future. If that were not the case, the Equalities and Human Rights Committee would never have needed to undertake this inquiry, and we wouldn't be here today debating its findings. Of course, the COVID-19 pandemic, which has brought the world to its knees, has certainly not helped matters. But this is a sector that was in big trouble even before then. Most of the problems set out in this inquiry predate this pandemic. And let's be honest, this is very much in part due to the SNP's government's approach to council funding. So the government really shouldn't hide behind COVID. It's actually 13 years of domestic failures. The stark situation, I'm going to make some progress, thank you. The stark situation charities face is in part through a political choice and is not all down to a misfortune of circumstances. Without local government cash, these charities and voluntary groups can barely keep the lights on. They need core funding to allow them to operate. The consequences of these organisations struggling to stay afloat are far-reaching. Whether it's children in poverty, women fleeing domestic abuse, or local groups who provide care to adults with learning difficulties, the third sector is an irreplaceable fixture within Scottish society. But it's not just those in desperate trouble who benefit. Third sector organisations help more people improve their skills and careers, and more than play their part when it comes to aspiration and reaching potential. Evidence given to the inquiry described what was a depressing state of affairs, faced by so many groups trying to improve the prospect of normal Scots. Equate Scotland, who aim to get more women involved in science, have said they can no longer provide one-to-one career clinics which support women seeking work. Why would any government be satisfied that this kind of problem was developing under its watch? A government that is serious about the third sector would not allow this to happen. As a sector, it has so much to offer, more than just simply helping people at their lowest ebb, though that is a crucial factor too. The voluntary sector employs more than 100,000 people in Scotland and around 3.4% of the workforce. They are talented people who provide economic benefit by paying their taxes and contributing back to society. Even before lockdown, the SNP planned to cut council budgets by more than 200 million. If the pandemic has taught us anything, it's the immense contribution made by charities and voluntary groups who put the needs of others before their own. And I would like to put it on record my own personal thanks to each and everyone involved. Society cannot afford to live without them, and nor can the economy. So we need to see a commitment now that the government will support this sector going forward. It could start by adopting one Scottish Conservative proposal which would create a permanent financial settlement for councils, ring-fencing vital money. Let's not forget that the work carried out by these groups would often fall on the state were they to collapse. So the Scottish Government must heed the evidence of those who took the time to get involved in this inquiry. And we must all ensure that the next time Parliament meets to discuss the third sector, it's to pay tribute to a remarkable contribution rather than discuss threats to its very existence. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Harris. And I call George Adam, the last speaker in the open debate. Mr Adam, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. You know, I'd like to thank Ruth Maguire and her committee for the excellent work they've done in what is an excellent report, because I've always valued the third sector. I've always felt the third sector plays a crucial role in our communities. From my early days as a councillor and Renfrewshire councillor, I could see it wasn't just a different way to deliver services. In many cases, it was a better way. And I can see that the Scottish Government wants to create the best conditions for the third sector and volunteering to thrive and contribute to the recovering economy and society. And the £25 million is a perfect example of that. But although, Presiding Officer, there were many people you could talk about, many have, about lockdown and what the third sector did in our communities, I will stick, because there was many in Paisley, I will stick with one organisation and its many component parts, and that is St Mirren Football Club. Many football teams claim to be more than just a sports club, but in the case of St Mirren, this is true. During the lockdown, St Mirren Charitable Foundation delivered emergency packages throughout the town, and they also worked with first team players to ensure that the supporters were okay during lockdown. Gail Branigan of the Foundation is a force of nature, and she ensures that the Foundation delivers for the people of Paisley and ensures that she is out and about getting the funding that that organisation needs. There's also the fact, and I have to declare an interest in this part, Presiding Officer, because I'm the convener of the SMISA, the St Mirren Independent Supporters Association Trust, but St Mirren FC are also part of a pretty unique partnership. In 2016, St Mirren Independent Supporters Association, SMISA, along with local businessman Gordon Scott, set out on a journey of fan ownership, a 10-year plan that would see SMISA own a majority of the shares in the club by 2026, ensuring that our club would never be the plaything of a currently wealthy or those attracting by the big bright lights of professional Paisley football. As this was, this is the bit, Presiding Officer, where it gets extremely interesting, because SMISA now will own a majority in the club next year after entering into this unique partnership with Kibble and Paisley. Kibble are a charitable organisation that have been around in Paisley since 1840. So effectively you have two of the town's great institutions in Kibble, 1840, and St Mirren in 1877, coming together to work in this unique way. And we took the German model of football clubs, where their commercial partner tends to be a major PLC or organisation, but we've done that very Scottish thing and gone for a third sector organisation. Because what club can you actually say is actually delivering for the young people in Scotland? You know, we can say that many of the young people that the Kibble actually work with are young people that go on to work in hospitality. If we can find a way using the club and its way of dealing with things to make life better for these people, so much the better. And that is the unique difference of the partnership we have. And that means that we, instead of in 2026, we will be fan-owned next year, working together with this organisation. Now, it's not been easy. It's been difficult when you bring business people together, when you bring a charitable organisation together, and you bring volunteers together. It's not easy, but nothing worthwhile is easy in life, Presiding Officer. You've got to step up to the challenge. You've got to be able to do it. I personally have always been a great believer on let's just be positive and find out a way to solve the problems that we have facing us. And I see an organisation like this, where you take an institution like St Mirren Football Club, an institution like Kibble, who are all working for the one goal and moving forward, I see that as a future for Scottish football and for fan ownership in Scotland.
Thank you very much, Mr Adam. And I now move to closing speeches and I call David Stewart to close on behalf of Labour. Mr Stewart, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm delighted to be closing for Labour on this excellent debate. Firstly, congratulations to the Equality and Human Rights Committee for securing this afternoon's debate on valuing the third sector. And I think convener Ruth Maguire set the scene well when she stressed how embedded the third sector was on all and each of our lives, not least during the current pandemic. Every member will have a connection with the sector, personal, family, through work and leisure. And I'm no different, Presiding Officer. I was a volunteer with the Samaritans in Inverness in my early 20s. I worked as an assistant director for SGO in my late 40s. And now in my early 60s, I'm a Scottish director for the Cot Death Trust, an organisation that supported my family through a time of grief and sorrow. And SCVO have made a key point in the briefing document when they said, and I quote, during the pandemic, a light was shone on the financial vulnerability of the sector. Trading for many organisations had ceased, public funding was halted, and demand for services and support increased significantly for many organisations, while others it was not possible to operate at all. And many members, such as Rona Mackay, Fulton McGregor, Jeremy Balfour and James Kelly, argued in their own contributions that the third sector funding is complex and precarious. Do we not now need a new compact between the Scottish Government and the sector to ensure its long-term financial sustainability? Surely the time is right to look for a new funding model which ensures that human rights and inequalities are central stage. As the NSPCC brief very aptly puts it, and I quote, the COVID-19 crisis presents an opportunity to make meaningful, sustainable, transformational change. We need to harness the desire to do things differently, to reach out to families with a strengthening social safety net to prevent long-term difficulties developing in children and in young people's lives. And in the debate, I was really struck by the consistency of positivity, if I can put it that way, Presiding Officer, on the contributions. Rachel Hamilton spoke about the third sector being crucial for Scotland and invaluable to our society. The Minister said that they, that's the third sector's work, started long before the pandemic and will continue long after it ends. Pauline McNeill talked about 20% of the sector reported charities are facing financial crisis over the next 12 months. Anne Beatrice Wishart talked about paying tribute to the third sector during the pandemic and made specific reference to Shetland. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I believe this has been an excellent debate with well-informed and insightful speeches across the chamber. I believe we owe a deep debt of gratitude to third sector for the work they carry out in Scotland, not as an optional extra, but as a key component in our welfare state. So surely the message from the Chamber today is we value the third sector in strengthening our communities, in delivering vital services, in building a well-being economy. So Scotland's budget for 21-22 offers an ideal opportunity to embed the sector as a key player in creating sustainable funding and reinforcing partnership role within a fairer, greener nation. And finally, as John Holmes famously said, there is no exercise better for the heart than reaching down and lifting people up. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Stewart. And I call on Alexander Stewart to close for the Conservatives.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Delighted to have the opportunity this afternoon to close on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives in valuing the third sector. Having served as a local councillor for 18 years, I am well aware of the work that takes place across the sector. And we've heard today about the 40,000 charities that are in Scotland and are supporting individuals and organisations the length and breadth of Scotland. There is no doubt that they play a crucial role in a very positive way in supporting individuals on a day-to-day basis. The third sector has a vital role to play throughout the pandemic that we are suffering at present. And that has ensured that as we move forward through the recovery in the weeks and months that will take place, we will see the third sector continuing to shine. They are, as an organisation and as a structure, they are there to support people on the ground, and they have the real expectations, and they're able to be much more agile to adapt to the changing circumstances and the changing environments that they face. And we've heard today in this chamber about the significant amount of public sector money that is required to ensure that they can thrive and survive. But many, Deputy Presiding Officer, have had difficult times, and this is prior to the pandemic itself taking place. The questions of sustainable funding is one that has been raised repeatedly. Many of these organisations rely on significant levels of funding, and that funding for the third sector has struggled to ensure that they have that continually being supported. We've heard today about the funding packages and the multi-year funding. That happens in some of the sectors and some of the organisations, but not all of them, Deputy Presiding Officer, are in that fortunate position that they do receive that multi-funding. They rely on councils and they rely on local authorities to support them. And since the Scottish Government has come to power, there has been, without question, a real terms funding gap in local government. That has been taken on board by many organisations and many individuals, and also some charity organisations themselves have spoken to the sector and have said that funding is a major issue. And we need to understand that. We need to support them to make sure that they do make that involvement. The Scottish Conservatives want to see a fair deal for local councils, and that they will require the Scottish Government to ring-fence a percentage of their budget year on year to ensure that local government is given something similar to the Barnett formula. If that had taken place, and we had seen that taken place, hundreds of millions of pounds could have been poured into local government. Instead, we've seen local government seeing hundreds of millions of pounds removed. And the Scottish Government have also ensured that budgets to many of the third sector have reduced since 2014. I'm happy to take an intervention.
Cabinet Secretary.
I kind of hear the largely conciliatory tone of Alexander Stewart, but I just want to put on record that the Scottish Government have tried and endeavoured to treat local government fairly. Local authorities have enjoyed a cash terms revenue budget increase of 3.6% over 2013-20. And if we look at what his own party has done to English local authorities, they've seen an equivalent real terms reduction of 22.8%.
Alexander Stewart.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the intervention. Scotland's funding has, in local authorities, been as a real terms, it has been reduced year on year since this SNP government came to power 13 years ago. These reductions in the funding alone do not help when council funding itself is coupled with the reduction to council services. Age Scotland have said that the third sector is being used to plug the gap for services that were previously provided by the public sector. And Equate Scotland, a charity aiming to get war women into science, have said that they're going to be unable to support some of these individuals because their costs have increased while their funding has remained stagnant. Now, we've already heard from the many across the chamber this afternoon, and I pay tribute to Ruth Maguire, the convener of the committee, when she spoke about the engagement that's taken place, that they've gone out and they've listened to and they've talked to many individuals and organisations who play that vital role. We've talked about partnership working, co-location, shared information, respect of the third sector, that's vitally important. Pauline McNeill talked about community groups that have supported during the pandemic. They have made the effort, Deputy Presiding Officer. They have saved many individuals and organisations from the depths of this pandemic to ensure that they can get that respect that they require in supporting people. Jeremy Balfour talked about the difficulties of income loss for many of these third sector and charities. A third of the sector has seen a dramatic decrease in their support and the supply of support that they can deal with. So I hope, Deputy Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government will support our amendment and consider and look at some of the conclusions that are made available before the end of this parliamentary session. So in conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, we in the Scottish Conservatives fully support the excellent work the third sector are doing here in Scotland, and they play a vital role to ensure that every sector is valuable and is looked after. There is extreme excellence work taking place every single day, and the pandemic, during many of the organisations within the pandemic, it has gone above and beyond. We cannot support, and we cannot see them disappear. They plug the gaps. So I am delighted to be participating this afternoon, and I pay tribute to each and every member, each and every volunteer who has gone that extra mile to support their communities. Thank you.
And I call on Aileen Campbell to close for the Scottish Government. Cabinet Secretary, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to close this debate on behalf of the Scottish Government on this really important debate about the third sector and how it is continued to be supported. And I want to also put on record my thanks to the many countless third sector organisations, the length and breadth of the country, that have done an inordinate amount of work over the last 9 months and beyond to help support and look after our communities. And I also want to put on record my thanks to the hard work of the committee and for the thoroughness of their work, exploring with a wide range of third sector partners, hearing directly from them and using that to instruct a really valuable report. And while COVID interrupted the timing of the debate for the committee's report, in many ways this discussion at this point in time is absolutely useful and really useful. It's useful because the last 9 months and the impact of COVID has shown just how important the third sector is to our people, to our communities and to our country. The reach they have, the variety of what they provide and the compassion that they show has been, as the SCVO's campaign slogan captures, they've been never more needed. And that is why early on in this pandemic, I announced £350 million for our communities, our local authority partners, third sector and TSIs to help support and ensure the resilience of our country. And over the course of the pandemic, I kept in regular contact with the third sector partners who were helping to administer the funding. And for that, we are sincerely grateful for what they did in that process. And also to the third sector partners who were delivering on the ground. Groups in Orkney, the Western Isles, Glasgow, South Lanarkshire. James Kelly will be happy to know that I did meet and engage with Healthy and Happy. And of course, in my own constituency, Healthy Valleys as well. And the impressive, we also met with the impressive Falkirk TSI, the one that Ruth Maguire cited and mentioned in her introductory remarks this afternoon. The third sector interface in Falkirk, though, supported by Stenhouse Muir Football Club, which again maybe illustrates the point that George Adam was making about how instrumental our community clubs have been to the resilience of our communities, and Stenhouse Muir is certainly one of them. All acting with compassion, all acting with care, and all doing what works in the context of their communities, communities that they know best. So we, in response to that, delivered the funding with flexibility and with trust, and partnership flourished at a pace and scale that we simply do not want to lose. And that is why, in amongst the trauma and awfulness of this pandemic, we are determined to capture the good changes, the things that did work, the messages that we got from the third sector about feeling over the last 9 months feeling valued, feeling supported, feeling trusted, and feeling respected. So even though the unfortunate prompt was a pandemic, we need to ensure that we use this moment to improve what we do and how we value our important third sector. And that's why my colleague Shirley-Ann Somerville and I established the Social Renewal Advisory Board with a key focus on what we need to change and the system that we need to disrupt to protect the third sector. The Third Sector and Volunteering Circle are examining how we do that, and the Social Renewal Advisory Board will report to us very soon. And in response to a demand for a move away from resilience to recovery, we also announced a £25 million community and third sector recovery programme in this year's programme for government. The programme opened for applications on the 21st of September and will run until March next year, and is designed to help charities, community groups, social enterprises and voluntary organisations to continue to provide ongoing crisis support to those in need. And it has two elements: Adapt and Thrive, which will assist organisations to plan and implement changes to their operating models and working practices to enable them to continue to operate in a very different social and economic climate. Communities Recovery, which will support organisations in planning and restarting the delivery of existing services for the communities and/or the development of new services identified as a priority due to the impact of COVID. And as well as that, as part of the winter support package, we will also expand and invest a further £15 million in this programme. And this funding will be used to enable more community and third sector organisations to feel supported and ensure greater resilience. Now, the actions and this funding is because for recovery to be about more than just reverting back to the old ways of doing things, we need to ensure that we do have a flourishing third sector. For us to translate the ambition of the National Performance Framework into a reality, we need the third sector. So on funding, I agree it needs to be multi-year now, and have endeavoured to do that in my own portfolio, but we do need to see that happen more widely across the rest of government, across wider public life as well. We also need to respect the third sector, which is why, in response to the advisory group on economic recovery, we committed to work to address the barriers facing the sector and to do this with local government third sector, taking on board the steer from the committee, which will no doubt be the case from the recommendations from the Social Renewal Advisory Board. But I do need to point out, Presiding Officer, that the Tories do need to realise that in their attempts, it feels like, to politicise what has largely been an instructive debate, that it doesn't help. The funding situation doesn't help when we continue to get a one-year budget, or if that budget continues to be delayed. It doesn't help that we've continued Brexit uncertainty. It doesn't help the third sector. And if the members who are shouting at the side would care to listen to the third sector, they will tell them that the callous welfare cuts certainly do not help the third sector to survive and thrive either. But let's not get bogged down by the attempts to hijack some of this debate, because that is not what the third sector want to see in their parliament. They want their parliament to be working together to ensure our third sector can continue to flourish. So we do have opportunities ahead, instructed by the really useful report that Ruth Maguire has led. We have an opportunity about the recommendations that will come shortly from the Social Renewal Advisory Board, our funding to adapt and to thrive to help our third sector to cope with the new situation they will be experiencing, a desire to move to well-being, away from GDP just being the simple way in which we determine whether or not we're a successful country or not. But we will need, along with that, the third sector to be flourishing. We need to see them respected. We need to see them at the head of decisions around budget, not at the coup's tail, which is quite often what happens. And we'll need to make sure that we continue to work with the third sector in partnership, and that will be the only way that our third sector will be able to flourish and continue, because we need them there alongside us on that journey. So thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. It's a while since I've heard the coup's tail mentioned, but there we are. I call on Mary Fee, please, to close for the committee. Ms Fee, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and it's a pleasure to close today's debate on behalf of the Equalities and Human Rights Committee. And the importance of the work carried out by the third sector has really shone through from members' speeches today. And many of our constituents rely on the services and the advocacy that the voluntary sector provide to lead their lives or to help them when they face particularly difficult times. And this has been evident in my own area in the west of Scotland through the work of Homestart and their tireless effort to support vulnerable young families in a variety of ways over the last 9 months, including supplying food and providing children's activities, has meant that 118 families across Renfrewshire have had some of their burden lifted. And as Pauline McNeill highlighted, the third sector has become a beacon in the community during the pandemic by providing essential services to our most vulnerable. And Beatrice Wishart, she spoke of the valuable work that the third sector do in Shetland and praised the Shetland community spirit. And can I take this opportunity to, presiding officer, to associate myself with the remarks made by George Adam about St Mirren Football Club and Kibble in Paisley and the fantastic work that they continue to do. And one of the central themes of the committee's report is increasing demand for services whilst funding is being reduced. And almost all of the written submissions that we received highlighted those funding challenges or expressed the view that public funding for the third sector should be increased. And Age Scotland believed that the voluntary sector was often left to plug the gap for services that were previously publicly funded, whilst other groups faced increasing demand at the same time as their budgets were being reduced. And the Health and Social Care Alliance reported a growing trend for local authorities to demand that third sector organisations deliver services ever more cheaply. And in response, COSLA argued funding of third sector organisations fell predominantly within the unprotected portion of council budgets. And in the 2019-20 budget, only 39% were unprotected. So when savings had to be made, COSLA said that councils have no choice but to take any necessary savings from service areas that fall within the non-protected area, meaning the welfare, infrastructure, the economy, and creation of sustainable communities budgets were affected. And cuts were therefore amplified in these areas, as a 2% cut in overall budgets became at least a 5% saving from non-protected areas. And Jeremy Balfour, in his contribution, spoke of the concerns that local authorities have raised and they have to deal with day to day. And members from across the chamber spoke of the concerns about funding and called attention to the fact that 20% of charities in Scotland do not think that they will be financially viable in 12 months' time. And these tensions only demonstrate the need for closer partnership working across central government, local government, other funders, and the voluntary sector. And it is clear to the committee that the current approach is not working and isn't sustainable in the long term, particularly as we enter a period of uncertainty due to the health crisis, where there are already signs of continued increase in demand for services. And as the convener outlined, there is a need for a long-term funding model for the voluntary sector. Short-term funding of 1 year or less creates unnecessary churn for charities. They spend time and resource applying for funding, and the people who work in the sector face the constant threat of losing their jobs if funding applications aren't successful. And this also results in time and money devoted to recruitment and training, adding a further burden and diverting resource away from frontline delivery. And I welcome the comments made by the Minister in her opening remarks on the move to multi-year funding. However, concerns remain, as speakers across the chamber have pointed out. And short-term funding does mean not only do charities lose talented employees, but they risk vital projects being compromised due to time and financial constraints. And the COVID-19 crisis has made the need for long-term planning ever more urgent, as unprecedented challenges and threats have emerged. And the pandemic has brought many pre-existing issues relating to long-term sustainability of the sector to the fore. And the Scottish Government's support for the sector during the pandemic has been welcome, but some groups are falling through the gaps and are facing very difficult times. Accessibility of funding streams arose during our 2019 deliberations on the third sector. We heard from the Fife Centre for Equalities about how challenging it was for smaller equality groups to access funding. And last month, in relation to the emergency funding provided by the Scottish Government, we were told that in Glasgow, organisations serving ethnic minority populations did less well in accessing emergency funding than expected. And it is vital that the government ensure that parity of access to funding is achieved. And the committee would urge the Scottish Government to heed the concerns that have been raised in this debate and in our reports and revisit what it can do to support the sector to ensure equal access to funding. And we know that reduced budgets and short-term funding contribute to a gap between national policy aims and the experience of the third sector and service users on the ground. And several examples of the failure of the system to protect rights were provided by those who attended the Glasgow TSI event in 2019. And a number of participants described those they support as being afraid of public services. Housing, immigration, social security, criminal justice and social care were specifically mentioned. And we heard concerns raised about disabled women not having access to key health services or screening, women fleeing violence, not being able to access housing or other key services. And these are not as a result of the pandemic. These are pre-existing concerns that we know will have been exacerbated by the health crisis. And in the Minister for Older People and Equalities' response to our report, she emphasised the role of prevention, close partnership working, outcomes-based performance to improve outcomes and to tackle inequalities in a sustainable way. And we've heard today there has been very little progress in the outcome for the sector and those who rely on it. The committee would therefore urge the Scottish Government to do more to address these very serious concerns. And in conclusion, Presiding Officer, can I again thank everyone who took part in the debate today? It is clear that not only is there widespread support for the third sector, there is also a great deal of respect across the chamber for the valuable work that the third sector do in all of our communities. And I support the motion in the name of Ruth Maguire, MSP. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Fee. And that concludes the debate on valuing the third sector. And it's now time to move on to the next item of business.